Hi again, everyone.
Hi, everyone.
So following on from the last video then, what do you do when you reach the mouth of the cave? What's likely to happen psychologically for you when you begin the process of disidentification with those shadows on the wall? And of course, that means gurus, guru ideologies, psychological theories, beliefs that we've held perhaps for most of our lives, and that have filtered and distorted our perception of reality to the extent that we were trapped. What happens then when we lose the familiarity of the prison of the cave and have to reach out into the world itself? And the track you've just heard and the video that accompanies it is really something that sums that up. It's a cross-modal zone where for a while we're incredibly unfamiliar with ourselves and with what we're experiencing. So simultaneously, we're going to get positives and negatives emerging at the same time. And the conscious mind, the ego, has to deal with that. And under that kind of pressure, people can falter. So it's really important that we discuss this and help people navigate their way out.
Yes, well, I agree with you. And for me, it has almost a bittersweet feel to it if I just allow it to impact me emotionally. And I think what you say about the emergence from the cave and letting go of those attachments to people that we've maybe looked up to and looked up to them inappropriately will be accompanied by a sense of loss.
Yeah.
And I think one way of helping yourself with that process of stepping out of the cave is to realize and to accept at a deep level that those people who were in there with you, who you almost felt were your friends because they felt so familiar to you, because their ideas felt so familiar to you, were not and are not your friends. You don't actually have the intimate relationship to them that you might fantasize that you have. And allowing that to just really impress on you, I think is helpful. In terms of allowing you to separate and to step outside of the cave and to realize that it has just been, a lot of it's been smoke and mirrors, a lot of it's been illusory.
Yeah.
And it's time to move forward and to move away from those attachments.
Yeah, thank you. So the guy in the song then is feeling all of that, isn't he?
Yes.
Yeah. He's standing alone again without a friend, but not sure whether he's happy or sad. The world's opening up for him. Yeah. Yeah. And as you say, that's the psychological state when you finally begin to wake up and penetrate into those illusions that we've held close to ourselves for so long. So rather than it being an immediate switch then where you go from one state to another, there is a transitional phase, and people can get stuck there if they're not careful, because that sense of loss is often experienced as a loss of animation, like leaving any kind of relationship. And then there's a feeling of depression, or people interpret that feeling as depression, whereas it could usefully be seen as a reordering of libido, ready to engage with the world again and move forward. And the narrative of the video does suggest that despite his feeling of being apparently depressed and lost and alone, he realizes that the world is a wonderful place. Mm. Life itself is wonderful, but both of those emotions are present and contending at the same time.
That's right. Yes.
So it's differentiating ourselves out from that when we make that move, isn't it?
It is. That the idea of like you say, Steve, that separation, it is a process. And so we shouldn't be surprised too if there are conflicting emotions present. It doesn't mean that that you're not moving forward. You are. And to some extent, it's just accepting that that will be the case for a while. And I think, like you say, the line that suggests that dreams hang in the air, well, that's such a hopeful thing.
It is.
But those dreams are out there. They're out there in the environment. They're not in the cave. They're to be realized in the outside world.
Yeah.
And so some libido has to be invested in that. And I think, as you rightly say, there's the importance of needing friends, even just one friend, to move you forward, to establish the idea that it's important to go out and relate.
Yeah.
And I think, like you rightly said in the last video, that it should be with people who know nothing about these ideas, just ordinary people. And I think if people go also to the original video and check that out, what you will find is that there are all sorts of people represented in that, all sorts of ordinary people, different age ranges, different stages of life. And it's about that, really. It's about going out into that world with all its variety and all its color, and to literally have a sensory experience, the kind of sensory experiences that children just readily have, that they engage with life through their senses far more than we do. And it's an invitation, I think, to do that again.
That's powerful.
It's extremely powerful.
Yeah. I mean, the opening line is, here I go out to sea again, which is reminiscent of the idea of a sea journey being part of the journey of life. Obviously, the Jungians talk about a night sea journey. It doesn't have to be a night sea journey, but the idea of going towards the horizon and having that spirit is important, isn't it?
Mm.
Hugely important. And as you say, all the different age groups that are represented, the different phases of life, ordinary people, and finding contentment in that, even if you have to be alone initially, but seeking out a peer group, because peer groups can entrap us, can't they?
They can.
Negative confirmation, it's just as bad as a negatively confirming family. You need to find yourself in the right place, don't you, with the right people.
Mm.
That's an active process of engagement, isn't it?
It is. And the idea of the line in the song, which is, I think, straight up in the sunshine. You know, for me, there's a dignity to that. I mean, it's not it's not a command. It's not telling people to, you know, stand up straight and put their shoulders back and, you know, go out into the world in that way. Yeah. It's just about finding a place to stand, even if the place that you're standing in means that to start off with, you're alone. Yeah. There's still dignity in that.
There
because
is.
Because what it's saying is that you matter, that you have inherent value yourself.
Yeah.
And by acknowledging that, by self-confirming, that will then allow you to go out and engage with other people and to relate in such a way that you then start to bring in those people to your life that are probably more likely to be your real peers as opposed to people that you just meet or people who would, as you say, and trap you in some other way. So
I like that. And as you're speaking, the images from the video are obviously running through my mind, and the way that it illustrates, as you say, all of those different people, different ages.
Yeah.
And we do have to be embedded in life, don't we?
We
can't be philosophers. It doesn't work. You're still in the cave.
Yeah.
But to go out into life, enjoy sensory experiences, as you say, to accept the phases of life. It's an individuation process. And the video for me anyway is a kind of recapitulation of that person's personal myth.
Mm-hmm.
He's showing where he came from as a child, how he was a misfit, how he's obviously been depressed, he's been in a cave of sorts, but he's opening himself out to the sunlight, to the sunshine, going on the journey again, being active about that, not being passive. And we can do this, we can all do it, and people need to do it, particularly when they're feeling depressed or going through that, as I say, phase shift from being locked into introversion, schizoid withdrawal, narcissism of sorts, projecting onto gurus and their fake personas, the shadows that they cast, the way that they contain and constrain people with all sorts of horrible ideas that are gloomy, black and depressive. But also, as you say, that the progression in the song and in the video is a simple, natural engagement that's free of dogma.
Yeah.
Absolutely free of it.
Yeah.
Which is the way life should be, because then who you are will emerge, won't it, from that?
It will. And it's gentle. It's a kind of an easing in of people from one state to another.
Yeah.
Like I say, there's no kind of bullying or aggressive dogma about how a person should do it. Ideally, it's just a very gentle easing in back into life, as you say, a natural experience of how good life could be,
yeah.
And often is. We're so, you know, caught up in our own heads, in our own ruminations, that we actually forget to just feel in that very naturalistic way. Yeah. And that kind of brings me on to the idea of suffering, really, which again we touched on in the other video. And what we try and do is to draw a distinction between emotional pain, which we all go through, that's unavoidable in life for all of us, that, and it, you know, we experience it probably right the way through our lives in different ways, but there is a qualitative difference between that and the idea of suffering, is suggestive of something that is prolonged and protracted, and never ends, and can't meet its end. And I think that's an important distinction to make as well.
It's a form of virtue signaling as well, isn't it?
Yes, it can be.
Particularly when it's encouraged by a religion.
Yeah.
Or religious ideas from a guru or a pseudo philosopher that advocates that kind of thing, because it's infectious through suggestion. Other people are brought into the idea that suffering is virtuous and you should suffer.
Yeah.
And whereas it's true that life is filled with suffering, as Buddha famously said, you do not have to endure it, and you certainly do not have to inflict that on anybody else. Mm. Again, the imagery in that video, it's very profound. It's on the coast, which is a point of crossover, isn't it?
It is,
two distinct places. It's very dreamlike in that sense. Mm. I think it's a remarkable song, and the original video is also remarkable, and we recommend that you look at that and get that emotional feeling. So when we emerge from the cave, then it's great, but it's also not, because we are unfamiliar with ourselves, unfamiliar with who we are right now, in the sense that we've let go of something. There will be a lowering of mood. There'll be an opportunity for complexes to rise. There'll be an opportunity for other people to insert suggestions of a negative kind in that then coalesce into complexes. But there's also an opportunity for us to say no to all of that. And that saying no is not cognitive. It's two things. It's affective, in other words, emotional and therefore instinctive. And then it's the goal of the affect and the instinct, which is action in the world, acting in the environment, makes you an agent for change, both of yourself and for others. But when you first come out of that cave, when you first drop the attachments to these gurus and others, whoever they may be, you'll feel a sense of loss. Be prepared for that. And of course, remember, it is a wonderful life.